So one day we're going to be coming back with Christ, second time. He's going to judge. And then we're going to go into the kingdom age. Satan will be put in the bottomless pit for 1,000 years. We're going to the kingdom age, and we are going to rule and reign with Jesus Christ, the church, the real church. We will be with him reigning and ruling.
Welcome to Somebody Loves You Radio, the Bible teaching ministry of Raul Reese in Diamond Bar, California. Today, as Raul continues our series in Revelation, we'll celebrate Jesus' saving power and incomparable love. As we get a God-given look into heaven, we'll see that Jesus, the Lamb who was slain for our sin, is the world's ultimate champion. For every believer, he has defeated Satan, conquered death, and redeemed our lives. Jesus is indeed the one who is worthy of all honor and praise. Today's lesson is taken from Revelation chapter 5. Here's Raul Reese.
When you talk about heaven, it's so awesome. Because there's no more tears, no more sorrow, no more death. We're going to be there forever and ever. And there'll never be darkness ever at all. Ever. Jesus will be there forever. He'll be the light. No more sickness. None of the things that we suffer here today, no more sin. In heaven, there's not going to be any of that. We're going to be worshiping the Lord day and night. Today is very hard to understand that because we see what's going on in the world and what's happening with people. Because when you think about hell and Satan, we know that he lives there. He tells us that in Ezekiel 28. But you know what's interesting about that? That in the book of Revelation chapter 12, in verses 10 to 12, it says this, that one third of the angels followed Satan when he got kicked out. And you're going to see tonight also that in heaven, in the throne of God, there's going to be millions and millions and millions of angels. You can't even count in heaven. And the church will be there. And the presence of God worshiping. And the title deed to the earth will be opened by one person, Jesus. As I was reading that, it really brought joy to my heart. Because Satan's here to undo what? Undo the work of God. According to Mark 4:15. Secondly, to make people turn away from God. Remember Job? In chapter 1, Job lost his whole family, all his income, everything. But before he did that, Satan came before the Lord. Because the Lord said, hey, where you been? He said, I've been up and down the earth. He says, what have you been doing? Well, I'm doing this, I'm doing that. But he says, have you ever tempted my servant Job? There's no one like him. And you know the story that he actually lost his family, lost his income, everything except nothing happened to him and his wife. But his children, his daughters, they all died. And the Lord told him, he says, you know what? I'm going to let you do this. Not because he hated his family, but because he was trying Job's faith. And I wonder tonight, how many of you have been tempted by Satan? His character, the deceiver, the father of lies, the adversary, the tempter. All these things that his character described. Deceiver. Father of lies. Adversary. Tempter. And I know that Satan wants to destroy the church. Not this building. The church. Not just this church. The churches he wants to destroy. Those that preach the gospel. Those that speak truth. And those that don't put up with sin. You don't hire homosexuals in your staff. The Bible speaks against that. And some of you that have daughters and sons that are in that lifestyle, you pray for them, but don't put up with their sin. Because if you put up with their sin, you'll never win them to Christ. they'll agree with you. They'll say, well, my mom and dad, they approve with me. 17, 20, 25 years, you pray for their salvation. They have an enemy that's like to them, Satan, the deceiver. And when I read chapter 5, I was so glad that I read it. Because the first question that I had on my own mind is, who lives in heaven? Who is going to live in heaven? And when you think of yourself, how do you know you're going to live in heaven? You shall know them by their fruits, the way you live. Do people really know you not by your name? Do they know you because of your fruit? The fruit you have in Jesus Christ. You shall know them by their fruits. And I think it's important for us tonight to really, really examine our hearts before Him. That we want to not only go to heaven, but who lives in heaven is, these are the titles, God, Christ, Holy Spirit, angels, and those that are saved are in heaven. I just love it. God the Father, Christ the Son, the Holy Spirit, the angels that are there by the billions, and the just saved. We one day will be in the presence of the Lord there. And so he begins in chapter 5, verse 1. He says, and I saw the right hand of him. The right hand of him. Who's that? God the Father. He saw the right hand, notice, who sat on the throne. Jesus is not sitting. This is God the Father. And he says here, who sat on the throne, a scroll written inside on the back and sealed with seven seals. Everything here that he's going to show us, it has to do with God and Jesus. The scroll, the hand of God in this book, not only written, but closed up, for no one could open it, nobody could read it, but it was only one person, and that is Jesus himself. I wrote a couple of things down here. The scroll, the hand of God, are those in the book of the form of two sheets of papyrus. Talking about that papyrus paper spread out 30 feet in the writing of God. And then you can roll it back up and sealed, as he says here, with seven seals. Nobody could open it, only one person. And that's Jesus. The way was being prepared for the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the Savior of the world. When we get to heaven, we're going to see God the Father, God the Son, that not only called us and saved us, and sent the Holy Spirit in the book of Acts. For 1900 years, the Holy Spirit has been here, and the Holy Spirit is living where? In your heart, in my heart. The Holy Spirit is the one that convicts me. The Holy Spirit is the one that lifts me up. The Holy Spirit is the one that brings me to a place of understanding the Word of God. So the Holy Spirit is very, very important in the kingdom of God. And I saw the right hand of him who sat on the throne, a scroll written inside, and on the back sealed with seven seals. And then he says, and then I saw a strong angel. They believe that the strong angel here is Gabriel. Not Michael. Gabriel. A strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the scroll and to loose its seals? Who is worthy? There was no one worthy but only one. Jesus. Nobody worthy to open the seal, not even the angel Gabriel. Nobody. And there's a purpose for that. The purpose is he wants to demonstrate how Jesus came, he died and rose again, and because he was not only proclaimed by the Father, but the Father sent him. For God so loved the world that he sent what? His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to die for you, to die for me. Christ meets all of our qualifications, believe it or not. He became flesh, so he's our kinsman, redeemer. Secondly, he loves us and is willing to redeem us. He paid the full price, so he is able to redeem you and to redeem me fully and completely. The the blood of Jesus Christ when he died on the cross. He shed his blood for me and for you. In verse 3, he declares. Now he's going to discover the whole compelling reason here why we worship Jesus Christ. He says, and no one in heaven or on the earth or under the earth, notice speaking of under the earth, was able to open the scroll or to look at it. Nobody. When you look at the place called hell, it's interesting that it's right below us in the center of the earth where the fire is. That every person that is there today and has been there for thousands of years, that one day they're going to be let out of hell. And when they're let out of hell, the Lord's going to take the Antichrist, the false prophet, every demon cast to the lake of fire. But then those in hell are going to be led out. They're going to stand in line. The books are going to be opened. And whoever's name was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. That's it. But those whose name was written in the book of life, your question may be, well, how do you get your name written in the book of life? Just repent. You accept Christ. And you live for Christ. Your name's there. And I've said this before, in the book of Exodus, Moses, the people of God got in trouble and God was going to start a whole new generation. And Moses said, Lord, don't do that. Why don't you take you have to take my name out of the book of life. So then the question comes up, and we've said it before, if my name can be taken out of the book of life, and salvation is by faith.
This is Somebody Loves You Radio with Raul Reese. It's our joy to help you discover the faith-building riches of God's Word. For a wealth of Bible-based resources, visit SomebodyLovesYou.com. And our app also provides a variety of ways to infuse the Bible into your life, and it's free to download. Let's continue with the conclusion of today's study.
And so as you go through these things in your life and you read the scriptures, the Holy Spirit has given me the power to live for Christ. You can't get up in the morning and say, this whole day I'm going to be whoever you want to be, and then come home at night and say, this is what I am for Christ. It doesn't work that way. To be for Christ is 24/7. 24/7. 365 days. All the time. Yes, we're not perfect. Yes, we trip. Yes, we fall. We go through all these things. And that's why Jesus Christ became the Redeemer. The Redeemer to forgive us our sins. If we're really, truly repentant, we go, Lord, please forgive me for what I have done. Lord, please forgive me. And he says, I have forgiven you. I went to the cross. I've redeemed you. But if you don't do that, you're guilty of sin. I just want to clarify that. And so here the title deed, nobody could really open it, only one person, and that is Jesus himself. Only him. If you notice verse 3 again, and no one in heaven or on the earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or the title deed to the earth or to look at it. Nobody could do that. Verse 4. So I wept much because no one was found worthy to open or read the scroll or to look at it. Wow. Can you imagine what that must have felt like? Recognizing the importance of the revelation that John contained in this book. And nobody could open, nobody could read it. And I guarantee you John wanted to read it. But he couldn't. It was sealed. And the only one that was going to be able to open it was Jesus Christ, the Son of God. The only one. Verse 5. But one of the elders said to me, to John, don't weep. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the scroll and to loose the seven seals. Who's that? The Messiah, Jesus Christ. He is the one, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. Judah indicates his victory would bring fulfillment, notice, in the promises of God to Israel too. To Israel too, the Messiah. One of these days he'll be the Messiah to them. But Jesus had his roots in David in Isaiah 11, verse 1 and 10. And I looked, and behold, in the midst of the throne and of the four living creatures, and in the midst of the elders, the church, stood a lamb as though it had been slain. Who's that? Jesus. The cross, the crown of thorns, the nails, the spear on his side, the water and the blood. For who? For us. For the sins of the world. He stood, he says, a lamb as though it had been slain, having seven horns. Horns speak of power, perfection, might. He says the horns, seven eyes, the perfect wisdom. And the seven spirits, notice that. The seven spirits, the perfect presence of God. And then, and God sent out into all the earth. Jesus came to die for the whole world. The sins of the world. He came and he died. When you think of the crucifixion of Christ, what they did to him. When he carried that cross, when they put those nails through his hands, through his feet, and they put him up on that cross, on a 3-foot hole, when it went down and ripped his armpits, his knees collapsed. And then as he stood there looking up to the Father, Father, forgive them, please. Forgive them. They don't know what they're doing, Father. At that moment, God was silent. Yes, the Father turned his back on Jesus. He didn't receive what he was saying. Why? Because he loved Jesus. He loved the world. He loved you and I. Otherwise, Jesus could not forgive us. He would have never gone to the Garden of Gethsemane, where he submitted himself to the Father. Father, if this is your will for me to go to the cross, I will go. And what happened? He went. For you and for me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. He goes on. The lamb as though it had been slain, having the seven horns, the seven eyes, the seven spirits. Seven is the number of perfection. The theologians would call these qualities omnipotence, omniscience, and omnipresence. All three are the attributes of God. The Lamb of God, the Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus. Nothing out of control, but everything in control. Everything at his hand. That's why he's God. Verse 7. And then he came and took the scroll out of the right hand of him, God, who sat on the throne. So here Jesus goes to the Father, takes the scroll, opens the scroll. He says in verse 8, and now when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb. Each having a harp, golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayer of the saints. Did you know that in heaven they're praying for us? And your prayers are going before the throne of God? And let me explain a little better. You're praying for your son or your daughter, you die, they didn't get saved. When you go to heaven, you're still what? They steal the prayers of the saints. Your prayers are still around the throne of God, and God answers prayer. God answered, listen to what he says again. I love it. He says, a harp, they're worshiping, golden bowls full of incense, and the prayer of the saints. So, falling down, they recognize the deity of the Lamb, 100% God, 100% men, Hebrews 4:15. And then also, you see the scroll again, the elders are showing them not only giving praise to the creator of the world. They're in heaven worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ. And then he says in verse 9, and they sang a new song. There's a lot of singing going on in heaven. Even if you can't sing now, you'll be singing. I'll be singing. I can't sing, but I'll be singing. And they sang a new song saying, here it is. You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals. For you are slain and have redeemed us to God by your blood out of every tribe and tongue and people and nations. The Redeemer of the world. The Redeemer of the world. We see that here that Christ died for everyone. You make a choice to accept him or to reject him. Verse 10, and have made us kings and priests to our God, and we shall reign on the earth. So one day we're going to be coming back with Christ, second time. He's going to judge, and then we're going to go into the kingdom age. Satan will be put in the bottomless pit for 1,000 years. We're going to the kingdom age, and we are going to rule and reign with Jesus Christ, the church, the real church. We will be with him reigning and ruling. And then I looked, and I heard the voice, notice, of many angels. Can you imagine? Look at many angels around the throne of God, the living creatures, the elders, the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000, 10,000, 10,000. Man, I can't even count that long. Think about that. Millions and billions of angels around the throne of God. I can't picture it. I don't understand it. But it's going to be a sight not to be missed. Not to be missed in any way. Here he tells you this is going to happen. Then he says in verse 12, they're singing, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. The first power, might, power. Secondly, he's worthy to receive riches. He is worthy to receive wisdom. He's worthy to receive strength, to receive honor, respect, to receive glory, and to receive blessing. To receive glory.
We hope you've been encouraged by today's assurance that while there's still a battle raging around you every day spiritually, the victory has already been won by your champion, the Lord Jesus Christ. You're listening to Somebody Loves You Radio with Raul Reese. Today's lesson from Revelation chapter 5 is available to you in its complete form for a donation of $5 or more. To get a copy, just call us at 800-634-9165. To further anchor your faith in the strength of your Savior, we'd like to tell you about Raul's entire study of Revelation. This 28-part series is available on both CD and USB drive. In each lesson, you'll learn more about God's matchless sovereignty, perfect justice, and astounding mercy as you explore His plans for the world's last days. Visit SomebodyLovesYou.com or call 800-634-9165 to order Raul's 28-message study of Revelation. We'll send you the thumb drive for a gift of $30 or the CD collection for a gift of $36. Again, that's 800-634-9165. Or you can write us at Somebody Loves You Radio, P.O. Box 4440, Diamond Bar, California, 91765. Somebody Loves You Radio with Raul Reese is fully listener-supported. Your tax-deductible donations are a great blessing to us, and we're thankful for your partnership. Tune in next time for an enlightening look at how Revelation parallels end-time prophecies from the Old Testament book of Daniel. You'll see how God wrote the final chapter of world history long ago, and you can be confident it will unfold just as He has said. Here's Raul with a closing comment.
And then he says in verse 13, and every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth, notice that, such as are in the sea, all that are in them, I heard them saying, blessing and honor and glory and power be to who? To God the Father, sits on the throne and to the Lamb forever and ever and ever, Jesus. The one that not only has saved us, but the one that paid the penalty of sin, death, so that we could have eternal life, so that we could go to heaven and be with the Father, be with the Holy Spirit, with Jesus, forever and ever to be with him. In verse 14, and then the four living creatures said, amen, so be it. And the 24 elders, the church, fell down and worshiped him who lives forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Imagine that. One day, we're going to be there.
I am falling in love with you.
This program is sponsored by Somebody Loves You Radio in Diamond Bar, California.